Welcome to the Scientific Sense podcast, where we explore emerging ideas from science, policy, economics, and technology. My name is Gil Epen. We talk with world's leading academics and experts about their recent research or general areas of topical interest. Scientific Sense is an unstructured conversation with no agenda or preparation. We cover a wide variety of domains where new discoveries are made and new technologies are developed on a daily basis. We are most interested in how new ideas affect society and help educate the world how to pursue a rewarding and enjoyable life rooted in science, logic, and information. We seek knowledge without boundaries or constraints and provide unedited content of conversations with researchers and leaders who love what they do. A companion blog to this podcast can be found at scientificsense.com, and this podcast is available on over a dozen platforms and directly at scientificsense.net. If you have suggestions for topics, guests, and other ideas, please send them to info@scientificsense.com, and I can be reached at gil@epen.info. My guest today is Professor Dale Rogers, who is a professor of business at Arizona State University. He is also the director of the Frontier Economies Logistics Lab and the co-director of the Internet Edge Supply Chain Lab at ASU. Dale is a leading researcher in the fields of reverse logistics, sustainable supply chain management, supply chain finance, and secondary markets. Welcome, Dale.
Nice to be with you.
I want to start with the Logistics Managers Index, LMI, that you manage along with a number of colleagues in different universities. I guess it's a combination metric based on responses of managers on various aspects of logistics, such as inventory, warehousing, and transportation. Could you describe what data goes into it and how it is calculated?
Yes. So the Logistics Managers Index, it's five universities. It's one old guy, me, with a bunch of younger faculty.
And they do all the work, I suppose.
They do a lot. They do a lot of the work. I do a little bit, but that's true. They do a lot, and really good researchers. And most of them, you know, have either been PhD students of mine, or I hired them, or a mentor in some way. And one of them, the young professor who works on this, Dr. Zach Rogers from Colorado State, and he does a lot of the management of the actual survey and so on. He actually, in addition to be a young assistant professor of supply chain, he's also my son. So the other guys aren't my son, but sort of like being my son. So we've got Colorado State, Rochester Institute of Technology, Stephen Carnevale, Rutgers University, Dr. Shen Yenyurt, who I hired for his first academic job a long time ago, and Ron Lemke, I used to work at University of Nevada, Reno, and Ron's still there. And I hired him back in the early 90s, I think. So a bunch of my old friends, and we were thinking, you know, GDP, gross domestic product, is a terrible measure of the economy. It's just a really bad measure. How come? Well, it tells you what happened. It doesn't tell you what's going to happen, and it tells you in the most micro way. Yeah. So GDP only measures from the last stop to the consumer. That's the only measurement, and you don't see all of that upstream activity in the supply chain that actually can be an early warning system, both for good things and bad things. And we've thought for a long time that the logistics components, if you measured them, would be very helpful in understanding both what is happening throughout the whole economy, because it touches on the entire economy, not just the last step on its way to the consumer. And also, it tells you what's likely to happen, because there's a ripple effect as things move through the supply chain. We're clearly seeing that happen now, as you know, you just think about the PPE and the ventilators and all those supplies that you need in the testing equipment, testing supplies. We're in the middle of COVID-19, and you can really see that it would have been nice to have an early warning system so that you knew a couple of months ago what was going to happen, you know, 2 months later. And so the Logistics Managers Index is designed really to track activity in logistics components, transportation, warehousing, and inventory. And what we do is we ask people, it's real easy to take because we know people are busy and they're not going to take something that's long. So we ask them, I mean, it literally takes less than 5 minutes. We ask them, you know, for instance, the transportation prices, did transportation capacity, did transportation utilization, did those things go up, down, or stay the same? And then we assign a number weight to each answer. So if they said it's going up, we give that 100. If it's going down, we give it a 0. And if it's staying the same, we give it a 50. And then we average those together, and anything over, for each component over 50, means that the sort of the crowd, the majority, thinks that there's increases there. And it's been really interesting. We've been doing this for the past 4 years, and you can really see what's likely to happen. And you don't just see it at the last minute as it's at the consumer, but you also see it upstream, and really something the last couple of years, well, last year and a half, and you can really see this before COVID, we were able to see, you know, everybody said we had such a great economy, and the consumer economy for the last couple of years has been really hot. Mm-hmm. But upstream, we were starting to see, you know, a degradation in the economy, in the upstream economy, before you got to sort of the retail sector. And if you think about it, you know, look at, say, for example, what happened to FedEx during 2019. So they missed their earnings in both the third quarter that ended in late September and the fourth quarter that ended in late December. And how come was that? Well, it was because they were seeing a decline in the business to business, that upstream stuff that you didn't pick up if you were only looking at GDP and the consumer. So everybody thought, well, GDP is so hot, but really we were starting to see changes in the upstream part of the economy.
So to look at it a bit more detail, Dale, so there are three components, right? Transportation and warehousing. And under the transportation warehousing, you look at capacity, you look at utilization and pricing, and then inventory. Again, how much inventory in the system and pricing of pricing or cost of inventory. So there are multiple factors, and some of them are inversely related, right? Capacity and utilization, perhaps, or capacity and pricing. So how do you combine all of these different factors into a singular index?
Well, we make it so they're moving together. So you're absolutely right. Some of them are generally inverse relationships, although some things that we've seen have been surprising month to month, where things that would normally be an inverse relationship are not. So But we keep things that are going to be going the opposite way. We sort of flip that around when we're developing the overall LMI, truthfully. So we're pretty careful about that, because you know, transportation capacity and transportation utilization are likely to move inversely. And like, for instance, for June, transportation capacity actually went down, although it's really right at the, you know, if you round it off 49.56, it really is 50. So it really was unchanged. Mm-hmm. But transportation utilization and transportation prices actually moved up quite a bit. So it's interesting. And honestly, what we found so far is that the wisdom of the crowd is pretty wise. They don't lie.
Yeah. So how many companies are involved typically?
Between 100 and 200. So, okay. You know, statistically, it's not a good sample if it's under 100. So we're always over 100. So it's between 100 and 200.
And are they all the same for?
No, absolutely not. We deliberately don't. We deliberately like a mix, and we can pull different components out. Like, for example, a carrier, a truck may have a very different perception than a ocean carrier or a 3PL or a manufacturer that's only sourced in China, or a wholesaler distributor. And actually, we say, hey, if you don't feel comfortable, you know, answering, that's fine. But I love seeing what the commercial real estate guys think, particularly around the warehousing components. So we have a pretty diverse group. We manage that pretty carefully. I want it to not get out of sync, actually. And so we have some sort of ways we manage that internally.
Yeah. So, but month to month, though, Dale, the ones that you selected, let's say in June, are they the same in July, or you have a difference?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So across time, they're generally the same. How do you?
There's about 10% difference month to month, because, you know, truthfully, these days people change jobs and companies and honestly, there's a lot of guys I've known for a long time that are retiring. So every month I get, hey, Dale, this has been interesting, but I'm going to go play golf and I'm going to retire. So I won't know anymore. So we have some of that. So it's 5 to 10% change.
5 to 10%. Okay. And how do you take into account, you know, any sort of size effect? Are they all of the same sort of size in terms of?
No. And actually, one of the things that's important, and if you go to the website that has the results of all of them, which is the-lmi.com. And, you know, this is a completely free thing. We're not selling anything. This is a research project, as I said, with one old professor and then a bunch of young ones. Yeah. And so we also break it down by sort of upstream and downstream, because we think that's very interesting. So there's another index that's similar to us, and we're good friends of them, that's also done here in Tempe, Arizona. And that's the Purchasing Managers Index, which is a very old thing. And the two guys that started the Purchasing Managers Index, Dr. Hoagland and then his student, Dr. Fearon. Dr. Hoagland was my professor back in 1981. Mm-hmm. And I knew him until he passed away. And Dr. Fearon, you know, really started the supply chain program here at ASU. He was a student of Dr. Hoagland at Michigan State, where a lot of us come from in supply chain. Yeah. And including me, and came out here to Tempe and is still around, actually. I think he graduated in 1960 or 61. And you know, the Purchasing Managers Index for the first 20 some years of its existence was very controversial, because some economists said, hey, you're double counting activity. You should only measure it at the GDP level. And And Dr. Hoagland in particular was very strong about, gosh, you get advance warning if you're seeing it when it's at the steel level, as opposed to the washing machine going from Home Depot to the consumer. So the PMI works exactly the same way as the LMI. The LMI, though, includes more downstream activity. So the PMI tends to be only upstream.
Yeah.
And it was interesting because we were rattled a little bit during 2019 because their numbers and early 2020, their numbers were lower than ours. And we usually always check to make sure that we're kind of in sync. And like I said, those guys are Paul Lee, the gentleman that runs the PMI, is a friend of ours. Okay. And so we always check to see where we are. And we figured out, you know what, this is a downstream upstream thing. So not only do we look at it by different types of companies, but we also look at it by sort of position. Yeah. In supply chain. And if you go to the website, you can actually see a breakdown for 2020 and some of the other months. You see it for the times, but you can kind of tell when we figured out, hey, wait a minute, the reason why we're different than the PMI is because we got downstream as well as upstream in there. So you can really see the differences between folks that are close to the consumer versus folks that are back a ways in the supply chain. It's a really interesting thing. So we deliberately keep the respondent base diverse, and we like to look at what those differences are.
Right, and you have been doing this for 2 years now. So you have
four years. Yeah.
So there's 4 years of data, and you mentioned that there was some interesting things to see. Maybe 12 months ago, 18 months ago. So what were your observations before this whole COVID thing hit? And then since then, I guess there is a gradation of information in terms of how the market is internalizing the full effects of it. So what did we see maybe 12 months before the COVID actually hit the economy?
Well, what we saw is anything related to the consumer was great, but that the upstream activity was cooling. So what that said to us, if things would have stayed the same, we were headed into, I don't want to say the recession word, I don't want to say the R word, but yeah. but we were, you could see the growth leveling off upstream. Mm-hmm. Which all the economic models that are based just on GDP weren't seeing at all because the consumer was so hot. So the consumer was really hot, but about a year and a half ago, we really started seeing, and you can see it, you can get onto the website and see the numbers and play with them. And we always welcome comments and sometimes arguments, we're good with that. We actually take into consideration what people who are really, we get some dumb comments, truthfully, but most of them, many things are very thoughtful, and many companies are using this to help them plan a little bit because it's surprising how accurate we asked for both this month and then 12 months from now, what do you expect? And it's interesting how accurate it's been up until the COVID time, where that's been so disruptive, none of the predictions, included that. Interestingly, though, while we've been in COVID, there really is a strong belief. There's an optimistic belief by logistics managers that things are going to be better in a year, which is interesting. And I hope they're right about that. So it's been a very interesting it's been a very interesting journey, and we just started it because I was thinking about the PMI and about how logistics components specifically are good indicators of the future. And the PMI does a great job, but they don't include all the stuff that we do.
Yeah.
And so we thought, well, we should do something that focuses on on logistics. And you could really, just to sort of go back and tell another story about this, in 2007, summer of 2007, so the recession really started to bite in September of 2008, if you remember that.
Yeah.
Well, in the summer of 2007, I was over at a big 3PL, one of the really big ones. And they had a bunch of orders canceled. And it was upstream kind of carriage. So it wasn't consumer stuff. It was upstream stuff. And I was thinking about that, and I was talking to the boss of this large 3PL, and he goes, we're concerned that we're starting to see manufacturing orders starting to slow. Well, that was in the summer of 2007. And I thought, I wonder if things are getting cooler. And, all of my recent former students at the time, I was living in Reno, and they were flipping their houses and playing this real estate game. And I thought, isn't that interesting? And I believe that logistics has been a leading indicator for a long time.
Yeah.
I've been a professor of logistics for more than 30 years now. And so I was thinking, man, there's something up here. Of course, I had no idea how big the shock was going to be. Right. But particularly in Western states like Nevada and Arizona and California, it was tremendous. And that shock really reverberated around the world. And you could see the beginnings of it in, I think it was July of 2007. So 13 years ago. So yeah. I thought, well, this is interesting. And I've been talking about it for a few years. And then 4 years ago, talking to these young guys, and my son, Zach, who was a PhD student here at Arizona State, was just getting ready to move to Colorado State. And I said, that thing we've been talking about? He goes, Dad, let's do that. And so we got the other guys, and some of them are econometricians. And so we've been doing it ever since. And it's really interesting because it seems like it's been very predictive. With logistics, you can actually see things. It's kind of like when you throw the stone in the lake. It's kind of like seeing the stone go in the lake rather than just seeing the ripples that emanate from where the stone hits the lake. And all the consumer measurements kind of see the ripples way at the end of it, as opposed to, when the stone hits the water.
Yeah, so it's very interesting, Dale. So the recent observations, again, if you kind of rewind time 12 months before COVID hit, you actually saw sort of the upstream metrics beginning to soften, and it would have indicated in a normal time, it would have indicated maybe a slowing down of the economy, maybe not quite recession, but definitely a slowing down of the economy. And then post-COVID, are you seeing sort of things coming back up in the upstream metrics?
Yeah. Yes. Well, it truthfully, it's a yes, but. Yeah. So yes, but only certain industries and types of products. So, if you look at grocery stores, for example, or that whole grocery retail supply chain, for most of the core products in that supply chain, this has been a great time, except for the cost increase because of having to be more careful because of the virus. So costs have increased in that supply chain. But truthfully, when costs increase, a lot of times that's good for the people that are absorbing it and using some of that cost to add services or different attributes to the supply chain. So So, and now in other supply chains, apparel, you know, shoes, certain kinds of electronics, it's been disastrous. There's a whole chunk of the economy that just has almost disappeared rather quickly. I mean, look at all of the retail bankruptcies you've seen. It's not the grocery retailers that are going bankrupt. It's the department stores and the fashion stores. I mean, you know, a terrible business to be in right now would be women's apparel. So it depends, and we look at that pretty carefully, you know, by which industry is doing what. And I mean, it's really logical. It's something that I'm sure your listeners could figure out. Some industries are doing extremely well and have had to add capacity, and some are not. So you know, it's surprising that the furniture industry, a lot of pieces of it are doing great. You know, the Home Depots and Lowe's of the world, some of that stuff is doing really well. But you don't want to be selling apparel right now.
Yeah, but the overall metric seems to show some uptrend, right?
Absolutely. So from May to June, we saw a 7-point difference. Now, some of that is a negative thing. Yeah. So you got to think about this a little bit. So to some extent, a lot of the U.S. logistics system is sort of constipated. So there's a lot of inventory that has come in that doesn't have anywhere to go. And so you've seen inventories go up and warehousing capacity decline because the warehouses are full.
Yeah.
And the warehouse decline has increased or decreased, I guess you would say, quite a bit from May to June. So warehouse utilization is real high. Warehousing prices haven't really gone up in the last couple of months, and that tends to be lagging a little bit. But you'd expect some of that to happen. I'm on the board of a sort of Airbnb for warehousing, a company called Flex, FLEXE. They're based in Seattle, and you know, Flex is getting calls from all sorts of folks who you wouldn't normally consider because they need temporary warehousing because they want to expand. They want to be closer to the consumer, and they've got some products that are moving really quickly. And then maybe they have some stuff that's slow moving that they're going to move somewhere temporarily because they don't want to throw it away. You know, if you look at the secondary market, which is fueled by returns and so on, and you know, 20 some years ago, I wrote a book about reverse logistics and been studying it for more than 25 years, I guess. You know, the secondary market, that's jammed full of certain kinds of things. You know, apparel and shoes are not going to get to move very quickly. You know, we have a really well-developed factory outlet mall system. You know, we've got the value retailers like Ross's and TJ Maxx and Marshall's and all, you know, Home Goods and all those guys. And those guys are stock full of inventory. And so it's been a really interesting thing to sort of look at, okay, who's doing well and who's doing not. And, you know, I think you could look into the future and kind of guess that if this thing lasts much longer, there's going to be a fair number of retailers, maybe not just do Chapter 11, but maybe even Chapter 7. And what we're seeing as trends that were already taking place in the economy over a long period of time, those trends have been accelerated. So like, for instance, we're losing about 10,000 retail stores a year. You know, it's going to be at least 30,000 this year, and it might be 50,000. So, number of malls, 3 years ago, we had 1,200 enclosed shopping malls in the U.S., we've really increased the number that are closing. So it's a very interesting time. So the virus, I think in the end of this, it's going to make whatever recession that we're in, I think it's likely to make it shorter, because we kind of had this long-term slide, and then all of a sudden, bang, the slide got accelerated. But if you remember the global recession, the recession cycled through the U.S. economy, which was the cause of it, really.
Yeah.
Much quicker than, say, it did in Brazil, for example. I'm a part of a research institute down in Brazil.
Yeah.
And we got a cold in the U.S., but they got pneumonia down there. Mm-hmm. And truthfully, they never really have emerged from that. A couple of years, but really they've kind of been in recession since the global recession, which really we caused, but it cycled through quickly. I think the virus is likely to cycle it through. We're really sick right now, but it seems like it's getting better quickly.
Yeah, that's interesting. So your hypothesis is that, having looked at this data for many years, Dale, correct me if I'm wrong, we were on a track into slow growth, perhaps recession. The shock seems to have accelerated it, with the net effect of maybe the economy getting out of that slow growth phase a lot faster. The stock market seems to have done exceptionally well. It is sort of inexplicable in many ways.
I don't think inexplicable. So let me tell you what an old professor thinks, and there may be folks out here that would disagree with me, but really, there's not much risk in the stock market if you think about it. How come? Why is that? Well, the investors know that the Federal Reserve is not going to let this get out of hand. I mean, isn't it amazing what the Fed has done compared to what happened in the 2008-2009 recession?
Right.
It's hardly a ripple, isn't it? Well, that's because the Federal Reserve appears to have inexhaustible resources, and they're going to use them. And the investors know what's the real downside here. And maybe these are great prices right now. Let's get on this, because the Federal Reserve is going to backstop everything. You know, they learned from both the bad recession, which you remember how uncertain that was in 2008-2009. They learned from that. Look, everything in the end is going to be fine. And they can already see the not invisible hand, the very visible hand of the Federal Reserve.
Yeah.
And the stock market's going to be fine.
Right. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So it's really a liquidity-driven upswing. The question is, when the foot is off the accelerator, what will happen, right? Is there sufficient value added in the economy to support it? But that is...
So this is important. So I think this is important for your listeners. And it's kind of what we've been talking about the whole time. The economy is not the same as GDP.
Yeah.
GDP is a very small percentage of the economic activity, right?
Right.
I mean, it's a very small amount. And if you look at the massive amount of the economy that's sort of invisible to most measurement, because it's upstream, it's in the supply chains, it becomes real clear that this is a gigantic thing.
Yeah.
Also, if we would have been measuring the economy well the last 25, 30 years, we would have realized, hey, wait a minute, a bunch of stuff that used to be in the US is being sent overseas. Mm-hmm. And we couldn't see that in GDP, you know, having everything that's at a Walmart made in China seems like a good thing for the economy because it shows up, you know, you can buy more. And so GDP tends to go up. But if you were really thinking about the true large economy, you'd be thinking, wait a minute, we've moved a ton of our economy outside the US into other places. And you know, if you think about it, you kind of already knew this intuitively, but we don't know the measurement on that, do we?
Right.
I mean, we don't. So.
Yeah. I mean, it used to be GNP, right, at some point, and then we switched over to GDP.
Yeah, although that wasn't a good metric either. You know, you really need to be measuring every step. And you can say, well, wait a minute, aren't you double counting? Absolutely, you are.
Yeah.
But all those businesses that only exist upstream, all of their revenue is coming from business to business revenue.
Right.
And that's valid economic activity. It's okay if you count it more than once.
Yeah. I agree. Dale, I want to quickly jump into your book entitled Supply Chain Financing, Funding the Supply Chain and the Organization. Could you talk a little bit about supply chain financing and how, you know, sort of the finances of the organization is intricately connected with supply chain, including the capital structure of the firm and its options to actually manage the firm?
Yes. Well, so the sort of the premise of the book and the work we've been doing in this area is that the supply chain has been used for a very long time to sort of make, source, deliver. That's been the role of it.
Yeah.
But today, it's really, you're asking the supply chain to actually fund, F-U-N-D, fund the organization, as well as to move product and information and all that stuff up and down. And an example of this would be Apple. So Apple, and I haven't done the numbers since I was teaching class in the spring. So it's probably February or March when I calculated this out. But I have the students in my grad, my supply chain financing class, I have them calculate the cash conversion cycle and the different components of the cash conversion cycle, how quickly you're turning business operations into cash. I have them calculate that out. And I remember for Apple on days of inventory outstanding, which is one of the components of cash conversion cycle.
Yeah.
For Apple this spring, they only had 10 days worth of inventory globally inside the whole corporation. Well, you know, that's not really the case. You know, they have access to lots and lots of inventory because they have billions of dollars of sales every year. But what they had figured out how to do is to move as much of that inventory as possible onto their supply base and then only take ownership of it right at the last minute.
Yeah.
And so it's the idea that you're using your supply chain and you're using, you know, your inventory and you're using your accounts payable and your accounts receivable to manage, which those are components of working capital, to improve your working capital status. So you try to hold on to your money as long as possible. You try to keep investment and inventory as small as possible. And you try to accelerate payments into the firm. And supply chain financing is a lot about really looking at your working capital and what and are there ways you can use your supply chain, particularly usually upstream, to help fund your corporation like Apple has. You know, Apple's been the most valuable company most of the last 5 or 6 years. And one of the reasons is that they really understood this supply chain financing idea for a lot of years.
Yeah.
And there's this whole industry, started with banks, but now has moved outside of banks into what we call fintechs, financial technology firms, right, who have grown up around the way of facilitating different kinds of payment systems in order to make suppliers healthier, because most all of the large corporations, certainly American corporations, have slowed down their accounts payable. So, you know, 10 years ago, it was not atypical to see 30-day payment terms. You know, we've taught for years at the university in a purchasing class, 210 net 30, you know, that whole, so you get a discount if you pay in 10 days, but you got to pay by 30 days. Well, truthfully, mostly that's gone out the window. And, you know, a lot of companies, you could pretty much name any large corporation you can think of, and they're probably at 120-day payables now. So there's been this whole, as firms have realized this idea, let's use our supply chain better, let's use our suppliers particularly, let's leverage them. And there's been this whole industry develop to try to make those suppliers healthier at a minimal cost so that they can afford to keep buying raw materials and components and so on. So in turn, they can sell to the big guys who are not going to pay them as quickly.
Yeah, it's, you know, the supply chain optimization used to be in the realm of operations management, right? What the book really making it clear that it's really a combination of operations, corporate finance, and technology, that, you know, those skills sometimes are quite different in the organization, but you have to bring those skills together to really manage the whole system, right?
Right.
And that, yeah, go ahead, sorry.
No, that's absolutely right, because, you know, if you think about where most of the assets of a firm are, not every firm, But if you think about where most of the assets for most firms are, it's in the supply chain, right? It's all that inventory, it's the factories, it's all that stuff. And if you can manage those assets better, and really what we've been doing over the last 25 years is we've been moving assets outside the firm, and in many cases, outside the firm to another firm that's in a different country like China. You know, that's what we've been doing. You know, when I was a kid, and I'm an old guy, but when I was a kid, you know, Converse, the shoe companies, Converse made their sneakers in Malden, Massachusetts, and in New Hampshire. Adidas made theirs in Germany and France and stuff. And Nike came in the early 70s with a disruptive model. They couldn't afford their own factories, otherwise they would have built them. And they used factories in Japan that belonged to other companies. Well, in 1970, it made sense to manufacture sneakers in Japan. But by 1985, it didn't make any sense at all because the costs were too high in Japan. So Nike just kept moving down the labor cost curve, and it gave them a huge advantage for a long time before the other sneaker companies started doing that. And Converse, who I'm a big basketball fan, Converse, who owned the basketball shoe business with Adidas, Converse ended up going bankrupt and being bought for $300 million, not a lot of money really, by Nike. Converse is now a division of Nike. Mm-hmm. And obviously there's no manufacturing in Massachusetts or New Hampshire of Converse right. Chuck Taylors anymore.
Right. Yeah. So in conclusion, Dale, if you look forward 5 years, what are the kind of the net effects of the shock that we're going through right now? It's really difficult to predict how long this is going to last, but more strategically in the supply chain, global supply chain, what would be the net effects of the shock, you think?
You know, that's a great question. That's a great question. So look at what's happened. the, just let's just take the last 10 years.
Yeah.
And how many disruptive events there have been. I think it's more than normal number of disruptive events. Mm-hmm. So think about 2017 and all the hurricanes we had here. Right. And think about the tsunamis around the world and you know, the other diseases, the other pandemics that didn't really get to the U.S. There's been a ton of disruptions. And, you know, in 2000, maybe 1995, the sort of supply chain operation strategy was, let's move manufacturing to China and then we'll bring it here and, you know, maybe manage it out of Singapore or whatever. Hmm. And today I think companies are thinking, look, from a risk management perspective, we've got to have duplication in our supply chains. We've got to be more resilient. And so I don't think we can put all of our manufacturing in one location in Asia, in Latin America, and wherever. We need to be a little diversified and have redundancy. Mm-hmm. And so you lose economies of scale to some extent. But I think you're seeing a lot of companies, certainly led by the tech industry, really looking at diversification and redundancy a little bit as you start to build out places. So if there is a gigantic tsunami in Japan again, you know, maybe you're safe because you're also in Mexico and maybe Hungary, or at any rate, you're more diversified. And it makes sense if you think about, you know, truthfully, in supply chain, the last few years, I've been borrowing a lot of stuff from finance. But, you know, to some extent, you know, the old idea of portfolio theory,
yeah,
that's still a pretty good idea, I think. Mm-hmm. You know, I think it was written in 1951, maybe, that portfolio theory by Markowitz, famous finance professor, and to some extent, we're still figuring that out in supply chain.
Yeah. That's very interesting. So, you know, sort of distributed, more distributed manufacturing, really more flexibility introduced into the supply chain, that you can move things around a lot faster, a lot more flexible fashion. You know, this was all kind of intuitively known to corporate managers. But I think the problem is that when you put numbers into a spreadsheet, you say, well, if I manufacture all the stuff in a low-cost country, you know, I can shave off another penny from my cost structure. And so that temptation is always there.
Right.
And once you do that, when you hit a shock, that's when you realize that, you know, the value lost from that strategy could be substantially higher than all the pennies that that the firm picked up, you know, in front of that that train, so to speak, that was coming.
Right, that's absolutely right. I completely agree.
So this has been great, Dale. Thanks so much for the time that you spent with me, and good luck with LMI. And I think that is extremely useful for all managers.
Right. And any of your listeners are interested in participating, they can go to the-lmi.com and you know, there's nothing, we don't charge for anything. It's just a research effort. So they're welcome to download whatever they want.
Excellent. Thanks so much.
Yep. Nice talking to you.
Bye.
Bye.